Hey yo, what up? This is the almighty Proclean at ProcleanCreations.com. Give it up to my boys, Rook and Sapient, Irrational Responders, coming to you live and direct.
Join us right now in the chat room at www.rationalresponders.com. If you are listening to our live stream, join us in the chat room at www.rationalresponders.com.
And welcome to the first episode of the Rational Response Squad. I am one of your hosts, Brian Sapient. With me to my left is
Rook Hawkins. And with me to my left is
Yellow Number 5.
And we are
the Irrational Response Squad.
So, what is rational? Because I don't have a doctorate degree. I don't claim to be a genius. I claim to be rational, and I don't think that you need to be a genius to be rational. Let's just real quick address this so that nobody thinks we're trying to pull the wool over their eyes here. Rational means to have or exercise the ability to reason, to be of sound mind and sane, to be consistent with or based on reason, logical and rational behavior. And that is rational, and all three of us are very rational. In fact, together...
Well, that's not sane.
Yeah.
Well, that's debatable.
I believe that together, the three of us can pretty much figure out anything in this world. We've figured out that there's no evidence for a God.
No, there's no evidence for Jesus.
Well, have we?
Yes.
Mike, are you with me?
Oh, yeah, I'm with you on that.
No evidence for Jesus. Okay, just making sure all three are in concurrence. That's the power of the squad.
No convincing evidence for Jesus.
Uh-huh.
There's stuff out there. I wouldn't call it evidence.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I would call it regurgitations.
Yeah.
But really, that's the power of the squad, is that, individually, each one of us has our own opinions. And, when we're apart from each other, we might have differing opinions. But when we get together and put all three heads together, myself on philosophy and debate, Rook on Bible.
And ancient texts.
Yeah, and ancient texts. And Mike on science. Between the three of us, there's nothing we can't figure out. Yeah, before we get into any guests, later on in the program, we'll be joined by Brian Flemming, a musical guest, Proclaim, great hip-hop artist, and also Sunsara Taylor from worldcantwait.net. But before we get into guests, we wanted to address some mailbag and also a little bit more about us. We had some questions submitted in to us from MySpace and other places around the internet. And so let's get right to the first question. The question comes from Geek. And the question is, how many of you are there and how did you meet? Oh, there's three of us.
I think there's three of us.
There's three, yeah.
So we met online. All three of us met online.
Yep.
Yeah.
Rook and I have known each other for about 5 years now.
Yeah, a little bit more than that, I think.
Really? Wow. Yeah. Okay, time's flying.
Yeah.
I used to have a show on atheistnetwork.com called The Book of Sapient, and Rook was a recurring guest on the show.
Mm-hmm.
And we met at atheistnetwork.com originally.
Yep.
Mike?
Basically, Sapient called me at about, 1 o'clock in the morning one night when he found out that I lived in the Philadelphia area. And he pitched this idea for a new show to me and loved what it was all about and was on board from then on. And, I've of course knew Sapient and Rook from my dealings, with them online in the past. We were both pretty frequent posters on infidelguy.com.
Yeah, InfidelGuy.
And that's when I first got acquainted with him. Actually, today is the first time we've all three met in person.
That's so. Right. I've never met Rook before today.
No, really. It's been that long, and we've never actually gotten face-to-face.
And the funny thing is we consider each other pretty much best friends.
I mean, yeah, we are very good friends.
So, we had a contest out there. The contest was to submit some questions to us for Brian Flemming, to submit some questions to us to the Rational Response Squad, and to help us figure out our irrational precepts that were going to kind of be the foundation of our show. And we wanted to award Geek with a video of the God Who Wasn't There, the movie The God Who Wasn't There.
Congratulations, Geek.
Yeah, so Geek on MySpace, we will be contacting you shortly if we haven't already, and we will be sending you a video. So congratulations.
I wish I won a video.
Yeah, you were not getting a video for promotional purposes. Geek, if you don't want your video, you can send it back to Rook. He really wants it. Yeah. So, Bitchtrog from MySpace submitted a question. How do you determine what is rational in an irrational society?
Well, I think that we should definitely look at Hamaruki's laws.
I smell a segue.
I do too.
Yes.
That's kind of ironic, don't you think?
I do think it's ironic. You know, I don't know how that got in there, but that is a perfect segue to talk about our irrational precepts.
Okay.
What are the irrational precepts?
They are Hammurabi's laws.
Yeah, Hammurabi's law. I love that. Was that Hammurabi's laws? Is that what that's based
on? No. It is based off of that, but these are rational responses to irrational precepts. The top most irrational things that need to be eradicated from the earth.
And so we kind of had a little contest out there to figure out the last few irrational precepts. We had about 7 or 8, and we didn't want to stop there. I mean, you folks that were following along know that the top 6 were theism, creation science, Pat Robertson and Jerry Falwell.
Yeah, the big ones.
Yes. The fourth irrational precept is religious terrorism, fundamentalism, and born-again Christianity, all wrapped up into one.
I think that works.
You folks may not realize this, but it is irrational to feel that you are agnostic and not an atheist or a theist. You must be an atheist or a theist. It is scary.
Yep.
But if you do not have a positive belief in a God,
you're an atheist.
You are an atheist.
Right.
The day you were born, you were an atheist.
It has nothing to do with the belief. Agnosticism has to do with knowledge.
Yes, exactly. And we're going to address all that in a full 1-hour show. In fact, that's what we're going to do with every irrational precept. We are going to have at least a 1-hour show dedicated to each individual rational precept. And you can look forward to them sometime after our 4th episode.
Yep.
The first 4 episodes, we're going to have some fun. We're not really going to deal with the irrational precepts much. We've got many years of shows coming.
Oh, yeah.
And so we've got plenty of time.
What did I sign up for?
A second ago, you were just praising us under the table, and now you're like, oh, I don't know, guys.
Is that him under the table?
Oh, I thought that was a cat.
Okay, so moving on. The 6th irrational precept is belief in psychics, paranormal, or supernatural claims.
Totally irrational.
7th is belief that America is a Christian nation.
Definitely irrational.
And that's actually the first one that was submitted by Chaos Lord from infidelguy.com. And Chaos Lord is also going to win a video for his help in the irrational precepts.
Yeah, he's on some really good things.
He's amazing.
He sent us a whole lot of information there and a whole lot of precepts that we should look at. And yeah, we're really thankful for that.
He's studying to get, I believe, a philosophy degree. Or what is this?
He's studying philosophy.
And so, and he deals with this, these irrational claims all the time in school. And so nobody submitted a list better than he did. It was really amazing.
He sent like 50, I think.
It was about 15 or 20 really good precepts. I mean, he really should be hosting the show. We shouldn't be doing a thing.
Let's just give it to him.
But he's going to get a video. And in fact, the rest of the list is dedicated to him. Every single one of these precepts were his. Some people did submit similar precepts to his. But the way that he worded them, he left us with no work.
It was pretty much cut and paste.
Yeah, exactly. With some of the other ones that came in, guys, thank you very much for all your submissions. And please, you know, when we look for submissions again in the future, please help us out. But, you know, he just did such a good job. We had to give him the video. And what he came up with is, of course, belief that America is a Christian nation is irrational. Saying evolution is just a theory and not a fact is irrational.
Mike would definitely agree with that.
Yeah.
The claim that science is dogmatic is irrational.
Again, I'm on board with that one.
this seems to be recently brought back up again by the folks in Iran, but I've heard it before. Denial of the Holocaust, claiming it didn't happen.
That's very, very irrational.
Very irrational.
Very irrational. I think they need to go visit Auschwitz and some of the concentration camps over there.
I don't know if we're going to make a whole episode out of that. That's going to be a tough one.
We can do it.
60 minutes of denying of the Holocaust. But we'll just have to find some deniers.
Yeah, I'm sure they're out there, the neo-Nazis.
Maybe get them on the show. That'd be interesting.
It might be scary, too.
Yeah, it could be very scary. Of course. So number 11 is thinking that logicians use logic to limit people's thoughts.
I think Tudangst would also agree with us on that.
Rook, could you help us out for the audience? What does that mean, thinking that logicians use logic to limit people's thoughts?
For example, when someone makes a poor argument and a logician will say, you know, that's an argument from popularum or, you know, that's an ad hoc fallacy. Okay, most people will take that as them actually trying to limit their argument, when in fact that's their argument that's already limited. So that's obviously taken by Christians to be, you know, logic is always said to be, you know, a made up regulatory debating tool, when in fact it's almost mandatory, because you need a sense of rules and regulations to govern what is reasonable and what isn't.
I got a feeling we're going to have Chaos Lord on a couple of these shows here.
I think we're going to have to.
Number 12 is the claim that the Bible is a good source for morality. Not.
Wait, what happened to the Crusades? What was that?
By the way, I don't know if I mentioned it, but if you want to read Hamaroki's Irrational Precepts along with us, go to www.rationalresponders.com and click All Things Rational on the left-hand side. The 13th one is the claim that mystical experiences can give us knowledge.
That's scary.
Yeah.
That's very scary.
The fact that Bush uses that left and right, it scares me even more.
The 14th one is holistic medicine.
Yeah, that magnetic bracelet's going to cure your diabetes.
Yeah, sure thing.
And the 15th one is thinking that this list is complete is irrational.
Very irrational.
By no means.
Yes, we will be adding more to the irrational precepts as we go along.
Let's face it, a lot of shit needs to get eradicated off the face of this earth that's irrational, folks.
All right, so back to mailbag.
Mailbag. Fun stuff, man.
Yeah.
Mailbag.
This is Sam Harris, author of The End of Faith and Letter to a Christian Nation, and you are listening to the Rational Response Squad.
Anyway, we got a letter here from Ardent Objectivist, and I don't believe that's even his MySpace name. This letter, I debated him back and forth for a little bit. But, you know, I found it funny because it seemed like he was hypocritical right in his first post. And
somebody hypocritical?
Yeah. Who? So anyway, I'll read it in its entirety, then we'll address the whole thing. We get a similar argument to this all the time. The letter states, "Why are you even arguing and debating with the religious community, especially Christians? If you had an ounce of reason, you would take in the stance that the vast majority of scientists have taken towards fundamentalist Christians with the notion of intelligent design, namely, not even bothering with them because it gives the idea of validation and credibility through the eyes of the media. In other words, why not just freeze them out? They don't have any proof of God's existence anyways." Wow. Signed, Ardent Objectivist.
Well, I first want to say that as far as him commenting on how scientists just outright ignore the creationists and the ideas. As a scientist myself, I absolutely do not agree with that. And I think you're seeing the results of scientists not stepping up, educating the public in our schools right now. You know, this creationist and ID movement should have been outright crushed from the beginning and not allowed to continue as long as it has. So, and I would think the same goes for Christianity and theism in general.
My problem with his argument was ridiculous. If you had an ounce of reason, you would take the stance that the vast majority, blah, blah, blah. If you had an ounce of reason, like how does he doesn't know me. And because I want to debate religion with somebody, that means instantly that I have no reason.
Right. I think the problem is we have pounds of reason and plenty to spare.
That's why you have Hamaroki's laws. My major problem with this is his stance of non-action. I think that's the biggest problem I have with this entire letter, is that it kind of invokes.
Don't do anything. Don't change the world. They don't have any proof that a god
but that
exists.
Doesn't,
so
that doesn't,
nothing to do.
Exactly, but that doesn't stop them from trying to take over the world as it is. That doesn't stop them from killing. It doesn't stop them from repressing. That doesn't stop them from oppressing people of all over the world because they think differently than they do. And they don't believe in their god, which they obviously believe in.
Ignoring a problem's never made it go away.
Exactly. Non-action is still a decision. You know, it's still a decision that's made, and it's just not the right one. You know, it's better to make the wrong decision in the end than make no decision at all, you know, make no action at all. I mean, it's just ridiculous. And I don't know how he's an ardent objectivist if he cannot see the problem with that.
Move to a quick song here. This song is actually from a hip hop artist out of Los Angeles who will be joining us shortly. His name is Proclaim. The song you're about to hear is called Brainwashed. And, you know, if you're a Christian out there, you're brainwashed.
Yeah, pretty much. Violation of our very first irrational precept.
And this is a kick-ass song.
Yes, this is a very good song. Hope you enjoy it.
We'll see you in a minute.
Back there in seminary school, there was a person there who show that you can petition the Lord with prayer. Petition the Lord with prayer. You cannot petition the Lord with prayer.
Check it out. Got you brainwashed out there, you know what I'm saying? How to address it. People out there running around with their fucking heads cut off and shit. Here we go. Check it out. They got your brainwashed, yeah. They got your brainwashed, yeah. They got your brainwashed, yeah. They got your brainwashed, brainwashed, yeah. I turn on my television, what do I see? Scheming celebrities, fast cash breeds, all greedy if you ask me. I'm moving so fast, ain't nobody that can pass me, outlast me. Pick up a couple bats, go ahead and bash me. False fields of protection, just kidding, homeboy. Don't wave that shit in my direction. I'm passing up elections, can't trust presidents on Viagra for erections. Thinking what their penis is, what a power and a biz. Even have a clue what imperialism is. Punch a rich white man trying to save their own kids. Stealing from Hussein, stealing from my main. On a corner hustling, trying to do his own thing. In the ghetto, in the hood, ain't a damn thing changed. People wanna bang, most fools wanna blame. It's just a marketing thing, all embedded in their brain. Saying, yeah, that shit's cool, wanna rock that shit to school. Gotta pay the light bill before you live in old school. Some fools, house rot, no cot, no water, none hot. But a badass Escalade sitting outside on the lot. Saying, yeah, that's my baby. Brainwashed cool, man, this fucking shit is crazy. Brainwashed cool, man, this fucking shit is crazy. They got your brainwashed, yeah. They got your brainwashed, yeah. They got your brainwashed, yeah. They got your brainwashed, yeah.
Trying to brainwash you and shit. Fucking president's kicking it, doing some foul shit. I wonder if, Valerie knows what's going on in the ghetto over here, the poverty level. I don't think so. Yo, Mr. Bush, at the ghetto, would you please take a look? The Iraq big rims. No, I forgot, you roll around in bulletproof limousines. Gas prices going up, they kicking with the Saudis, don't even give a fuck. I'ma catch you at a whack club, probably giving Dick Cheney back rubs. Michael Jackson to the left, saying, no, that's in step. I think he said it's, yeah, you got me off again. Me and OJ sip pen, thanks to you white man. Hot gen, getting married once again. Can't find love in fiction. Celebrities turn love into fame and prediction. Finding anyone who's stuck and dumb enough to listen. I'm here to tell you people just exactly what you're missing. I'm pissing off teachers, damaging religious leaders when they brainwash you with hate, hellfire, punishment. Stealing from the people just so they can be the rich. Claiming that just city man, you're just brainwashing them to buy the next rims, Tim's, a set of gems. We'll forgive you for your sins, but you can't be gay with gin. Too much contradiction, I'm done. Your brainwashing's won, I'm the underdog son. Still, I'm gonna save some.
On the phone with us now from Los Angeles, California, we have the artist Proclaim. The song you just heard was Brainwashed by Proclaim. Proclaim, what is up?
What's up, yo? How you doing?
Hey, we're good, man. How you doing?
Good, good, good.
Good.
So, Proclaim, what is, it's kind of obvious, but give me a little background to Brainwashed. What's it about?
The first verse kind of starts off talking about the stuff I see on TV every day. Turning on my television, what do I see? Celebrities, fast cash screens, just the whole fucking, a lot of VH1 shit, you know, about, people balling out of control, and everybody trying to sell everybody something, and everybody's a corporate sellout nowadays, and just kind of the indulgence, overindulgence in the material things, and people being blind to what's really going on. Basically, I kind of touch on the whole, stealing from Hussein thing, kind of, just kind of poking fun at that, just the whole idea of how we could just go over there and, rob somebody for their shit and bomb them out and kick it over and basically just mislead the whole world and shit in today's modern day. Just kind of, it's a pitiful event, but
right.
I guess I'm just kind of poking fun at it in a sense, you know what I mean? I mean, I know in the neighborhoods where I grew up in, there's a lot of damage going down still today, so
sure.
The fact that we're over there, not over here trying to do things, is, I think it's a calamity, you know what I mean? We need to do something about it.
Yeah, man. Where you grew up in L.A.?
Yeah. And I mean, there's people, you know, like I got a lot of homies that passed away, and people that, you know, just right now gang warfare in the streets. And I mean, I think it's more of an imperative and trying to go over there. I mean, if anything, you should have went over there and took out Bin Laden and shit. They couldn't even do that. So, I mean, just, you know, going over there to take over some other country that really don't want you there is kind of stupid in a sense, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, just, you know, with all the problems we got here, I mean, Sean Hannity was on some fucking show the other day talking to, you know, I don't know, but at Coretta Scott King's funeral, there was this black Democrat who got up and was like, and there was no weapons of mass destruction over there, and kind of said something about Sean Hannity, the right winger, was like, oh, well, you know, why did you say that? And he was like, you know, well, there's a lot of problems here that we need to deal with. There's poverty on a global scale. And he tried to say, oh, yeah, well, I'm from Atlanta, and I've been to some of the most fucked up places in Atlanta. And, you know, they've got running water. And, you know what I mean? Just basically like, dude, like, you ain't from there, dog. You don't know. Like, you ain't living there, dog. You don't know what it's like day to day living there with people getting gunned down and
right. Fools
fucking robbing and shit going down every day. Like, for him to even say something like that is just fucking stupid. You know what I mean? To, like, find eye and say, like, oh, yeah, we give them running water and you know what I mean? But, like, dude, you know what I mean? The education scale in these communities compared to the communities that they live in, I think is just a little bit different. You know what I'm saying?
Right, yeah. I'm sure Sean Hannity's had a real hard upbringing.
Yeah, he's a hard life. Yeah. You know?
The fact that Sean Hannity even has a show and it's considered news is a problem in America.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, big time.
So we also wanted to talk about the fact that most hip-hop music has strong overtones of Christianity in it. And, right. You know, you totally break the mold. What do people your way think of your music? I mean, you're talking about people being brainwashed and, you know, Wake Up is the next song that we're going to play from you. And,
right.
I mean, that's a totally different message than what you hear in most rap songs. I mean, what do your friends, what do your listeners think?
Oh, man. To be quite honest, man, I don't really have that many listeners, you know.
Is it because of your message?
Not really. You know what? I really am kind of a solo artist. I really do everything myself. I don't really do shows. I'm working on my next album right now after I finish that. And, you know what I mean? Then it's going to be about putting the music out there. And then I'm going to be seeing what kind of responses I get. So far, like, from people like my shit, like, all my friends, all the people I give it to, they like it, and they haven't heard some of the other hardcore stuff yet, you know what I mean, but they, like, so far, everyone's cool with it, no one said nothing. I mean, some people say, oh, it's too philosophical and shit like that, you know what I mean, some people have said they can't understand some of it, but I don't really give a fuck, that's their problem, you know?
As long as it's tight.
Yeah. But, I mean, especially because, like, say, in the brainwash, I kind of talk about, we'll forgive you for your sins, but you can't be gay with Jim. You know what I mean? Meaning, like,
right. Just
the whole contradiction. Like, we'll, you can be a part of us and give us your money, but, you know, if you're gay, you're going to go to hell and be burned and shit. So, I mean, I don't know. And plus, the fact that I speak up for gay rights and for people, you know, like that. You know what I mean? Like, whereas hip-hop, even towards them, is kind of downplays that, and everyone's talking about faggot this and faggot that. You know what I mean?
So even towards that,
I'm speaking out again. So it's like, I am, like you guys said, like, it really is a whole new voice. You know what I mean? Like, that I'm trying to create a whole new perspective that I'm trying to come out with. And even if, you know, the whole fucking goddamn culture thinks something else, you know, I'm still going to get my message out and say what I got to say, you know?
You know, it's funny. You know, you listen to a lot of rap and hip-hop, and a lot of the artists think that, you know, hey, they're pioneers. Like, before them, like, the game wasn't like it is now, you know? And the funny thing is you're actually doing what they're talking about, not and like what they're not doing. You know what I mean? So that's
right, man.
That's,
oh, like, when people say, oh, we changed the game. Like, oh, man, I'm changing the game, man.
Exactly. Yeah. I changed it up. You know, I did it all. It's all me. You know? No, man. Like, you didn't change the game.
You're part of the game.
Same stuff. You know, same message. You are the game. Yeah. You know, like Wyclef Jean, you know, like, you know, you got, here's another one, though. Tribe Called Quest, you know, like, they're different.
Right.
You know, and now
they're
you're coming out,
and
you're doing something different, and you're actually trying to change the game. That's good.
Hey, Proclaim, we have a large audience that, you know, would probably want to support an artist like yourself that's putting himself out there like this and kind of you know, bringing a new kind of music to a genre that, like we've already said, is predominantly Christian. Where could somebody buy your album if they want to buy your album? How would they go about doing that?
Well, right now I just got a website up and running. It fucking looks like shit because I'm not much of a web designer. But it's at www.proclaimcreations.com. There's a little products for sale thing right there, and I'm trying to like sell my demo CD that's for sale right now on PayPal for like $7. It's probably about 13 tracks with short verses and different beats and songs that I did. And I'm trying to sell that. Or if you got a PayPal account, just pay $7 to proclaim@hotmail.com. And, you know what I'm saying? It'll be on the way.
Okay.
Within a reasonable amount of time.
And we also have both Brainwashed and Wake Up available for download from our website for all of our registered users. So they can go to rationalresponders.com and download the two songs that we're playing in today's show.
It's well worth it.
Oh yeah, I'm also on MySpace too. If you guys have if anyone out there got a MySpace page, go ahead and add me to your MySpace thing. It's www.myspace.com/proclaimcreations. So you know what I mean? Be my friend.
Excellent. So hey, listen, we're gonna have to move on, but we want you to intro Wake Up for us.
All right. So well, this is Wake Up, another song about just trying to wake up, free everybody's minds out there to some new ways of thinking, some new trains of thought, you know. Time to put down the Bible, time to put down the 2,000-year-old folklore, and time to wake up and, you know what I mean, envision the new millennium. Like that, wake up, full plane.
I wake up, take a yawn in the late afternoon, sleeping too much. My room is like a tomb where I often hibernate, cold like a Kodiak. If you really listen close, know that I got your back. I appreciate that, like I appreciate facts. People make up trash and they try to spread that. I try to hold back, sometimes I just snap. I gotta set them straight, heads up, no debate. Hard to stay nonviolent in this day and age. Flip the page of the book right there, take a look. Dinosaurs used to roam way before the earth shook. Meteors, asteroids, comets, and stars. They might hit us too, but instead we catch stars and make atomic bombs while we write love songs. I'm trying to stay strong, everyone I'm taking on. Your culture, your history, every tradition. I'm trying to wake you up, take you to a few dimensions. I'm trying to wake you up, take you to a few dimensions. Of your mind, of your soul, get your life in control. It's time to wake up, it's time to arise. Thanks for another day, open your eyes. Breathe your mind, cause we on a rampage. Living for today and planning the next. Still read scrolls and I write my own text. Still read scrolls and I write my own text.
Now find a heart. Now find a heart.
I find it hard.
Now find a heart.
I find it hard.
I find it hard to believe, and what they say is true. It just doesn't seem certain. How does it seem to you? I'm doubting you too. Nobody's ever right. Don't ever try to tell me what heaven looks like. You've never been there? Nobody has. I went there one time, came back in a flash. Don't wanna be a lawyer, I was arguing with God. I had to make a case for the people living hard. The ghettos, the cripples, the chicks with no nipples. I said, how can this be? He said it wasn't simple. I set everything in motion. The first single cell swelled into deep ocean. I couldn't do no more. I gave you your freedom, what else can you ask for? I said, yo, thanks, everything is straight cool. I'm trying to wake you up, cause this is the new school. New technology, science, knowledge, innovation. I want to free the minds of the entire nation. I want to free the minds of the entire nation. Cause too much time you're wasting. 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 Way too much time everybody's wasting.
Wake up. Wake up. Wake up.
Everybody wake up, it's time to arrive. Thanks for another day, open your eyes. Free your mind, cause we on a rampage. Living for today and planning the next. Still reads goals and I write my own text. Still reads goals and I write my own text. Still reads goals and I write my own text.
Now find it hard.
I find it hard.
Now find it hard.
I find it hard.
Now find it hard.
I find it hard.
Now find it hard.
I find it hard to believe.
I find it hard to
believe. I find it hard to believe.
That I'm unhappy.
Gently they stir, gently they rise. The dead are newborn awakening, with ravaged limbs and wet souls. Gently they sigh in rapt funeral amazement. Who called these dead to dance? Was it the young woman learning to play the ghost song on a BB grand? Was it the wilderness children? Was it the ghost god himself? Shuddering, cheering, chatting blindly. I called upon you to anoint the earth. I called you to anoint sadness, falling like burnt skin. I called you to wish you well, to glory in self like a new monster. And now I call on you to pray. Now I call on you to pray. Last verse I just did was a piece by Jim Morrison called Newborn Awakening. It's time to wake up, y'all. Time to let go. Time to stop living in a stone age.
With us on the line now is Sunsara Taylor from worldcantwait.net. All right, and just so you know who you're on the phone with, I've got Rook Hawkins here. He's my biblical expert.
How you doing?
And we've got
great. Thanks.
Mike, also known as Yellow Number 5 on the message boards online.
How you doing?
He's our science expert right here.
Okay. I wouldn't say expert. Geek. Geek is a better term.
Oh, yeah, because expert and geek are so different from each other.
He's the closest thing we have to an expert.
Yeah, we couldn't afford an expert, so we just got Mike.
You get what you pay for.
Yeah.
So, Sunsara, we had you on today because we have a large presence on MySpace. And on MySpace, we have gotten bulletin after bulletin about the world can't wait and drive out the Bush regime and some of the events that you guys have been organizing. And we were hoping that you would help us out and just give us a little introduction to what it is that you guys are and what you're trying to do.
Well, essentially, we are a movement of people in the United States who are determined to drive George Bush out of office and to reverse the program and direction that he's been taking the country. Essentially, what we're looking at with the Bush regime is a government that's openly torturing people and justifying it. They've launched wars of aggression based on lies, taken tens of thousands of lives, and they're getting ready, you know, in Iraq, and they're getting ready for another war in Iran and other places. They're moving to deny women reproductive rights here and all over the world. They're moving towards a theocracy in this country. There's just, you know, suspension of civil liberties. This is a departure from any kind of way that this country has been in the past, and it's a fundamental remaking of U.S. society and international, the way the U.S. relates to the rest of the world. It's potentially permanent, and unless we stop it, there's no force in society, and there's no force in the political apparatus, the courts, the Democrats, the Congress, that is proving able or willing or both to stop the direction that Bush and company are taking the country. So we know that there's millions and millions of people who hate what's happening, and we're mobilizing them to drive out the Bush regime.
Right.
How can we do that on the grassroots level? I mean, how do we take out a president? And how do we take out, you know, more so the whole regime?
Without guns.
Yeah. Well, what we're talking about is a mass political movement of people who are mobilized in the streets and speaking out in the media and speaking from whatever stage or platform that they have access to and changing the political terms of debate in this country. For instance, you know, right now we've been watching the Katrina hearings, and there's a lot of talk about, you know, incompetence and cronyism, when in fact there wasn't merely incompetence in the Department of Homeland Security. They're extremely competent when it comes to spying on people. They're extremely competent when it comes to rounding up over 23,000 Arab, South Asian, and Muslim immigrants, which they've done. But they were, you know, consciously neglected a phone call, the warning that came in that said the levees would break in New Orleans. And so, for instance, that's just one arena, but there's a shift, there's a difference between incompetence and, you know, crimes that are committed. And I think that, you know, you could do the same thing around the war, around which we could talk about. There's a lot of arenas where the discussion needs to shift in society, where it's not just a matter of, you know, cronyism or incompetence, but actually crimes against the people of this country and crimes against the people of the world this administration has committed. And that's one of the things that will not happen unless people actually are mobilizing themselves out in the streets. We've held demonstrations on the anniversary of George Bush's election on November 2nd, and then during the State of the Union, trying to, you know, actually bring people together and get a sense that, we do represent the millions. We do represent the majority, and that's a voice that's not getting heard. So people think, oh, no, I'm the only one, right. Or, you know, what happened to everybody else? You hear it all the time. Where's the outrage? And so we're trying to actually bring together and get people to have a sense of themselves and to go on the political offensive. And then what you need to do, and it says in our call that launched our movement, it says we're aiming to create a political situation where Bush himself, where the program that he's pushing on society is repudiated, where Bush himself is forced to step down, and where the direction he's taking society is reversed. And by a historical analogy, you could look at, the events that led to Nixon being expelled, you know, resigning, which he obviously wouldn't have done had there not been such a political turmoil in the country that, you know, everything that he went forward to do, it was actually getting him more, you know, deeply unpopular. And even his own, you know, even within the ruling structures of this country, people, you know, were seeing him as more of a political liability than as a benefit.
So you're not, you're not talking about bringing forth treason charges per se. You're trying to create a situation where you bring everything out, all these things that had have gone wrong to light, and create enough, I guess, public and political pressure to force him to step down on his own? Or would you even go the impeachment route, though?
Well, we're in favor as an organization. We're in favor of any mechanism that works to get George Bush out of office, to force him to step down, whether it be impeachment, whether it be resignation, whether it be criminal indictments, any of them. We're in favor of all of them. It doesn't matter to us. And in fact, we don't think it matters to the people in Iraq either, what the mechanism is. Looking at the political alignment in Congress and with the president right now and the White House and the courts, we're looking at the political reality that there is nobody who's actually going to impeach him in this current climate. And so if we create the kind of political pressure that I'm describing and you're describing, perhaps that will be a situation where Congress does actually decide, members of Congress do decide to go forward with an impeachment process, and we'd be thrilled with that. So, and then on what grounds? Well, there's lying about the spying, which George Bush has, you know, been documented, saying, oh, we never spy on anybody without a warrant. And that was obviously not true. And I think there are indictable crimes around Katrina. I think there are definitely indictable crimes around the willful, and this is another one that gets reframed by the mass media, but the WMDs were actually a lie. That was not an intelligence failure. That was conscious misleading of the country and of the world. And those are things that and then the torture, the violation of international law and domestic law. There's open torture going on, and these new pictures just came out, and there's hardly anything being said about the new pictures that were just released from Abu Ghraib.
Right.
So I think that there is, you know, there's a tremendous number of indictable crimes and impeachable crimes, and we're trying to create a political situation where that stuff sticks. And right now, everything, you know, there's the Bush presidency is wildly unpopular, but it's not actually being held accountable.
That's a good point.
I've agreed with almost everything you've said.
Same here.
And Rook has as well. But Mike, you know, like, just for our listeners' benefit, Mike represents a portion of the population that's, you know, very intellectual. I consider Mike to be extremely rational. And, you know, he's also a skeptic, and he needs proof behind all of his claims. And, you know, he's not as able to jump on the Bush lied about WMDs.
Right.
Am I right? Is that,
well, yeah,
I see you shaking your head.
I'm more inclined to believe that the administration is simply grossly negligent and grossly incompetent than I am to think that they outright lied about it. And I don't even know how you would prove such a thing.
Do you have anything in that realm that proves, you know, just lies about WMDs, fabricated evidence?
Well, yeah, I do. And I regret that I don't actually have the at my fingertips, except to say that for one of the examples, and I should, and I could, you know, maybe in the future I could do this for you, get you this information. But one of the things that George Bush cited in arguing that there were WMDs in Iraq is one of the Atomic Energy Review reports.
Mm-hmm.
That actually, when it was researched back into what report he was citing, there hadn't been a new report, and you know, in the time period that he was citing, it was a fabricated report. There are things like this that were referenced that are actually, you know, and you have people like Ray McGovern, who was one of the CIA, one of the directors of the CIA, who was giving briefings to George Bush and to other presidents who have come out and said, look, he never wanted to know the intelligence. So you have people on the inside who've actually come out and specify that there was pressure to provide fabricated evidence or to make the evidence conform to the program and policy of war. There's quotes that in the meetings in the White House on the morning of September 11th, before anything was known or made public, but even before they really understood what happened, there was discussion of going in and invading Iraq that morning in the White House. So you have things like this where it's documented that this was their policy to go into, and they had plans drawn up to invade Iraq before they ever had any excuse. And then what they did is they fashioned the evidence and they fashioned the rationale, and it changed. First they had the WMDs that they argued, and then when that didn't stick, then they said, they also argued that they had links to, that Iraq had links to Osama bin Laden, which was, ridiculous claim. Then they said, oh, it's a mission of democracy, spreading democracy. I think even by their own methodology, you have to be suspect. And I think people should be skeptical and want the facts. You know, I think that I think that's a strategic strength of our side, is that we do want the facts to come out. And it's a strategic weakness of this regime, is that they have a big fear of the truth and they like to cover it up. Mm-hmm. Because if they actually told people what their real intentions are, I think they know, too, that people wouldn't go for it. So I think that, you know, there's documentation on the different lies, but then there's also the methodology that does reveal that there's something being concocted at every step along the way. The rationale changed.
I think the whole Joseph Wilson, Valerie Plame scandal is a pretty good piece. If I were to point somebody to some sort of evidence of, you know, foreknowledge and lying as opposed to just getting it wrong. Joseph Wilson was sent by the vice president's office to go to Niger to investigate claims of uranium.
The yellow cake.
Purchased for, the benefit of being purchased by Iraq. And it turned out that that claim was false, that the documents were forged, that the person who signed off the original document was somebody who wasn't even a government official anymore at the point when it was supposed to be signed. He came back, presented the evidence to the vice president's office. Somehow that information got into the State of the Union address after it had been proven to be totally inaccurate. It's not like it was, my family that sent, Joe Wilson over there. We're talking about the vice president, communications with the president every day, Their offices knew that the claim was bullshit, and yet they let it get in there. In fact, there was even a scandal around the fact that it was in there and then out. The CIA said, take it out at one point. And maybe you remember this, a speech in Ohio, I think it got in, and then the CIA said, how'd that get in? Make sure it never gets in again. And then it got in again for like 3 months later in the State of the Union was the next. In fact, at that point, the CIA said, don't let that get in. And it got in anyway. It's blatantly obvious what that is, to me, at least. To me, it is. I mean, I can understand that some people would still be skeptical, but to me, that's blatantly obvious that the Bush administration went out of their way to lie about weapons.
Oh, no, I do think we are in Iraq under false pretenses. I'm just skeptical as to exactly how nefarious those false pretenses are. And that's sort of always been my biggest thing. And I do think also that Bush and really the administration in general had its mind to go to Iraq made up. We're going to find some excuse.
I'm curious because the nefarious claims that that Mike, cannot accept, and I have a hard time accepting some of the off far end deep ones, but things like New World Order, Illuminati, Do you have...
Well, I don't... Yeah, no, I don't go for that. I actually... Here's... I think that there are things that are actually discernible and spelled out there. I think that George Bush actually does tell the truth about some things, including that during the State of the Union or leading up to it, he says, look, we're in decisive times, and the decisions that we're making now and the policy decisions we're making now are going to affect the lives of people for generations, and we're at a nodal point, sort of. I'm paraphrasing him. I think that's true. I think that when he talks about the U.S.'s strategic interests in Iraq and Iran and this sort of thing, he is revealing something of his grand strategy, or the people, at least the people around him's grand strategy for going forward. But I do think that within their strategies for how they're going to remake global markets and power relations and secure for themselves this sole superpower status permanently, which is one of their open objectives that they have talked about for over a decade, and this is part of why they planned on going into Iraq. I think they tell you these things. If you actually dig down beneath the talking points to their position papers and their think tanks and what they put forward as strategies. But then in the day-to-day working out of that and what they feed the population to get people to buy it and go along, you have across the board, whether it be I'm sure you guys have followed this, the suppression of their own scientists around global warming because they don't really want to get out there to this. Pardon me?
I've definitely followed that one. Being into science myself, that's really disheartening.
Yeah, so you have it from there to the constructing rationales for an invasion in Iraq to fit their predetermined strategies, to the fact, for instance, you have around reproductive rights, around abortion rights. You have, for a while, there was an anti-abortion organization that had put out these ads, paid ads that they raised money for on subways and stuff like this, that said that abortion is a trigger for breast cancer. Now, this was disproven. Wow. This was disproven over and over again, even by the governmental, the NIH studies. But now there are actually states in this country where abortion providers are legally required, before providing an abortion, legally required to counsel young women or women of any age and say, this could increase your risk of breast cancer.
Really?
That's funny.
Yes, there are. Pardon me?
That's funny.
You know, that kind of reminds me of the fact that religion increases your risk of religious terrorism.
There you go.
Yeah, and I think that this is part of what's so sinister about this administration. Now,
used the word sinister there. I mean, do you think that Bush and the people around him, do you think that they're actually acting on what they think is the right thing to do, that what they think is the best interest of the country, or do you think that they're just actively trying to screw us? You know, What do you think that their intentions are? Do you think their intentions are outright evil, or do you think that they do actually have good intentions? And at the end of the day, they're just really, really misguided about how they go about those things.
Well, I guess I would have a sort of a synthesis of those two. I don't see the dichotomy quite that way. I think that they are doing what they think strategically is in the best interest of America, the way they understand it, from their perspective, but by analogy, I think that's what Hitler was doing too. And if you read what he did and what he spoke about and how he mobilized his population, it was always for the good of the German people, for the German Volk.
That's a very good point.
And so I think that, you know, and I think Hitler believes what he's doing, and I think George Bush actually believes that he's on a mission from God.
I think
he believes he's doing something that's right, but I think it's, honestly, I think it's at least parallels the dangers of what this administration is doing. And this is something Harold Pinter said in a statement in support. He's been a supporter of this movement to drive out the Bush regime. He said that this administration is more dangerous than the Hitler, you know, experience in Germany because of the scope and the magnitude of its intentions worldwide and its reach. And this is, you know, I think that there is an analogy to be made there. And I think that the stakes are huge on that level. And so, you know, and then on the other level, I think that, as world can't wait, we have people within this group who think that George Bush is evil and doing it on purpose because he you know, just has a vengeance against people. And then there are people who think he's fumbling and bumbling. And then there's people who think, you know, well, he's really stupid. I mean, there's different views. So that's not the decisive thing as far as our organization, as much as looking at objectively what are the implications of his policies and his program and what happens if we don't stop them.
Right,
I think that's where we actually do agree. Yeah, go ahead.
I agree. The repercussions of his intentions, regardless of what his intentions are in fact nefarious. I mean, if you think about how many Jews are dying over there in Iraq right now, how many of my friends are over there getting shot at every day, worrying about roadside bombs. You know, I mean, that's the consequence of his quote unquote, you know, rightful intentions. You know what I mean? It doesn't matter what he thinks he's doing is right. The fact of the matter is what he's doing is wrong. And he's been told that so many times now that it's almost a little bit suspicious as to why he hasn't stopped.
We're going to have to move on to an interview that we have with Brian Flemming coming up, but just so people can know how they can get involved and what they can do, they need to go to worldcan'twait.net. And what types of things are happening that you guys need people to work on, that you guys need people to get involved with?
Well, we want people to come to our website and sign up on our email list. We have an active organization in over 70 cities, and we need people to start chapters where there aren't any yet. And at this point, we're doing a lot of fundraising and broad outreach to try to spread the word, because we've done 2 rounds of mobilizations, which have been actually very significant. But, and millions of people have heard of us, but there's still the majority of the country has not yet. And this movement needs to grow very quickly because the dangers and the policies of the Bush administration are getting bolted into place and normalized, actually each day as we speak. And so we're asking people to come to our website, to make donations, to sign up and get involved with us. We're holding house parties and meetings and really trying to build communities of resistance to prepare for our next round of mobilizations, where we do intend to, we don't have them planned yet, and we want people to be involved in planning these with us, but where we do intend to, once again, be out in the streets. And I'll end by just drawing the analogy. We've sort of drawn some inspiration from the movements in Argentina or the Ukraine, where people said, okay, the political framework is failing us. We are going to be out in the streets and go to the Capitol in the millions and drive this guy out. And so we want people to get involved with us and build towards that.
Are you working with any other organizations to mobilize in that way? MoveOn.org comes to mind.
MoveOn is actually, their main strategy is electoral and mobilizing people towards the 2006 congressional campaign. And we're looking at, for instance, just I'll give this example. Did you guys follow this guy Hackett in Ohio who was going to run in the Democratic primary for a Senate seat? And he's an Iraqi war veteran who just came home. He's running for office, and he was calling for immediate withdrawal from Iraq. He was calling, saying George Bush's people are just like Osama bin Laden. They're religious fundamentalists. He was way out there, really.
Wait, but
good
he's not supporting the troops, though.
Well, you know what happened is Schumer and Harry Reid called him up and said, you can't run. You got to pull from this race. And the reason they said it is because, honestly, the leadership of the Democratic Party is not allowing that into the political framework. They don't want to go there. They're dancing to the tune, a little different, but they're dancing to the terms that are set by George Bush's Republicans.
What good would it even do us then to drive out the Bush regime if those are the shitheads that we're left with?
Right, pretty much.
Well, that's why we're saying we need an independent political movement, and this is why we're not at this time working with Move On per se. We have a lot of people who are involved in both, but our strategy is actually people being out in the streets, not going with what's the quote unquote electable position. Political position, but actually going out there and saying we're changing the terms. We are not playing by those rules. We're telling the truth. We're demanding an end to this whole direction, and we're letting those in power respond to the terms that we're setting. And that's a different kind of a movement. And that's, you know, so there are different groups working with us. There's religious forces. There's, you know, people who are defectors from the administration, including, you know, Anne Wright, former diplomat, Janice Karpinski, who was one of the brigadier generals in Abu Ghraib prison and has spoken out about how...
Yeah, but she's not supporting the troops either.
No, no, no.
She's not supporting the troops either.
I know. There you have it. There you have it. But so anyway, we have a lot of people from different sections of society, and we need more. And this is the thing. There's not going to be a savior from the Democratic Party. And if to everybody listening who feels that and has been sensing that, you're right, and you need to come to our website. And this one's on us. We really have a responsibility ourselves to reverse this direction. And that's what we're doing.
You're absolutely correct. Yeah.
Thanks so much for joining us.
Yes,
and
thank you very much.
I hope you'll come on again next time. We'll have to talk about the fact that you're an atheist.
Yeah.
I would love to do that. That would be fantastic.
I like her even more now. So. All right. Take care.
All right. You guys have fun.
All right. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye. All right. Well, that was nice.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah.
Upcoming, guys, we have Brian Fleming. We're going to jump right into a song from Brian Fleming's movie, The God Who Wasn't There. And when we come back, we'll have Brian Fleming with us.
Excellent. Can't wait.
Was Every Single Day, a track off the soundtrack for the hit movie The God That Wasn't There by Brian Fleming. And we're about to get Brian on the phone right now.
Hello? Brian, it is Brian Sapient. How are you?
Hey, how are you, man?
Good. I've got my friends Rook here.
How's it going?
And
good.
And Mike.
Hi. Hi, Brian. How you doing?
Hi. So who's that again? Who's talking here?
I'm Rook Hawkins.
Okay. Great.
And I'm Mike. I post as Yellow Number 5 on a lot of boards, and I'm like the science geek for these guys, basically.
Great. Cool.
We just got done playing Every Single Day.
Okay.
That's a great song. We love the whole soundtrack.
We do, definitely.
Well, thanks.
And we were hoping that you would put us in touch with DJ Madsen. Who is DJ Madsen?
You're speaking to him.
Really, that is incredible. how is that some of that music compiled?
Well, a lot of it is from this album called the Wired album that was released under Creative Commons license and includes songs by David Byrne and Thievery Corporation and Zap Mama. I used some of that music and remixed it on the album. And I guess there's three songs that include remixes from the Wired album on there. And then the rest is the samples and original compositions and kind of a mix of everything.
Yeah, very cool.
Yeah, see, I just found out from these guys about 30 seconds ago that you are the actual force behind that music. Like, I definitely agree. It's a, you know, great soundtrack to the movie. And I guess you're just multi-talented.
Well, for me now, independent filmmaking is really about trying to figure out how to do every single part of it for yourself so that you can control the product and therefore say whatever you want to say in it. And so really what I do is I just spend a lot of time learning how to use software programs and learning about other areas that I'm not particularly, you know, expert in, cinematography, editing, you know, just everything it takes to make a film. So that's why I did my own soundtrack for this movie, was just because it's part of my whole philosophy of treating filmmaking like it's painting. You know, a painter doesn't hire someone for blue and someone else for red and right. All that. He does everything himself. So that's what I try to do with filmmaking.
Now, The God Who Wasn't There is certainly nothing like any movie that we see out there in the world today.
Definitely not.
Was it played in any theaters?
Yeah, it played as a sort of a grassroots theatrical run that's kind of ongoing today still. I release theatrical rights to anybody who wants to screen it. I don't charge any money. There's no royalties or any special permission needed to hold a paid theatrical screening of the movie. So a lot of humanist groups and atheist groups and other kinds of groups have held their own screenings of the movie as fundraisers for their group. And that's largely how the movie has been seen theatrically.
That's very cool.
Yeah, people just really rent out a theater, or they rent a hall and a video projector, or there's all sorts of different ways that they put it together. But, you know, that's mostly what the theatrical run has been.
For those listening who haven't seen the movie yet, could you give us just a brief rundown of what you were trying to accomplish with it and a little bit about what it's all about?
Yeah, I started out making a sort of a dry documentary about the what's called the Christ myth theory, which is a theory that Jesus Christ never existed and is entirely a figure of legend. And the film did end up exploring that theory, but it ended up using that as sort of a jumping off point to look at Christianity as a whole, including my own past with fundamentalist Christianity. So it examines things like the Passion of the Christ and why that movie is the way it is, includes footage from Passion of the Christ, and looks at the evangelical fundamentalist Christian movement toward theocracy. And kind of wraps up with a critique of the private Christian school industry and how what they teach children harms those children. So it's kind of a big film, a shortish film for a feature-length documentary, 62 minutes, that branches off into several subjects. And then it's really intended to be a DVD so that you experience the whole thing, because the special features on the DVD are really even more running time than the movie itself. And there's interviews and other special features to explore each individual subject in the movie.
Yeah, the DVD is definitely packed with interviews and things along that line. Definitely worth checking out. But you mentioned just now that you used some of Mel Gibson's Passion of the Christ in the movie to examine that aspect of the life of Jesus. Did you have any fears or qualms about using that footage? Do you think Mel's actually seen the movie?
Yeah, I noticed at the beginning of the bottom of the screen, it said footage used without permission.
Yeah, I wanted to be clear about that, because one thing that Mel Gibson could claim is that I was given the impression that he endorsed the use of the footage and the comments contained in it. So I made sure that everyone knows that Mel Gibson did not give his permission. Icon Productions, the production company that Mel Gibson owns that made the movie, did not give their permission either. I'm not too worried, because there is a concept in U.S. law that's called the fair use doctrine. And what fair use means is that you're allowed to quote from other works in your work, so long as you don't just utterly steal the essence of the other work and make your product a replacement for that other product. And as so long as you're doing it for one of three reasons, which are commentary, criticism, or parody. And essentially, I do all three with passion. And I'm not actually worried at all. I mean, if I have a sort of a reputation out there as an advocate for free culture, as the movement's called now, this movement against copyright extremism. And I have a feeling that if Mel Gibson knows about the movie, which I think he probably does, and if his lawyers have checked me out, they realize that I'll fight him. And all he'll do is get involved in an extremely well-publicized lawsuit that I will ultimately win. So I think they won't try anything at all. And if they do, I'm certainly ready to fight them and exploit that attention for all I can get for the free culture movement and the kind of bullying that Mel Gibson will be doing if he does take action.
Yeah, I would think movie sales would skyrocket from that lawsuit as well.
Yeah, they probably would. More, I would use it as sort of a public lesson for everyone in, you know, how you stand up to a bully who tries to stop you from criticizing his work by using copyright law. And I have a whole other side project called Fair Use Press that does just that. I've mocked Arnold Schwarzenegger as well as Bill O'Reilly for their use of intellectual property law to try to squelch their critics. And my strategy usually is just utterly ridicule the person as, you know, severely as possible so that they're wounded in response to any attempt to do that kind of strategy.
Is there a website for that?
Yeah, it's called fairusepress.com.
Okay.
And it's slightly unsafe for work because of what I do with Arnold Schwarzenegger. So be careful.
Definitely have to check that out then.
Yeah. I'm going to pull it up as we speak here. Oh, yeah, I see this Arnold Schwarzenegger. Yeah. Interesting. Fairusepress.com. You guys have to check it out.
Sue me, asshole.
So we had some submitted questions from fans. One of them here is, and I'll just quote verbatim, "Do you think that in the future the world will ever be free of religious violence and hypocrisy? And if so, how long will it take to recover from all the years of being under this oppression?"
That's a good question. I'm not really very good at predicting the future. I think I predicted every single presidential election we've ever had incorrectly. So I'm a terrible person to look into the future. I don't trust myself in predicting the future. I do think there's a chance that we can rid our culture of superstition, which I view it more as doing that, just getting a respect for facts and a respect for science into our culture and a disrespect for anything else as a belief system and a disrespect for all false belief systems, so that we're all reflexively sort of mocking anybody who thinks crazy things like religious people so often do. I think that we can get there. I think we're going to have to really fight to get there. And it's going to be uncomfortable along the way because right now people think it's impolite to treat religious people the way they deserve to have their ideas treated when they bring up an idea. Sam Harris says so well in his book and actually says so well in my movie, The God Who Wasn't There. He's got several interview points that he makes that I just basically, whenever the subject comes up, I kind of just steal from Sam because he's so eloquent on the issue. But he points out that what we need to do is when people start talking about these absolutely insane religious concepts as if they're meaningful, we have an obligation to highlight their idiocy for what it is and to start creating a taboo and a sort of a fear in people's part of bringing up ridiculous ideas in a public setting. And once we start getting there, I think that the pendulum will start to swing the other way. It's amazing to me that it hasn't. I recently took part in this full-length reading of Darwin's book, The Origin of Species, at the Center for Inquiry West out here in L.A., and I did a few interviews with press people afterward, and I found myself amazed that I was being asked to defend Charles Darwin, who wrote that book so very long ago, and it's so utterly sensible, and we still, after all of these years, literally more than a century, we haven't managed to even get people to accept the theory of natural selection as if it is science. So there's reason not to hope, but I think there's also reason to hope in that at least we're right. You know, those of us who want our public discourse to be based on facts and reason and good argument, we don't have this sort of narrow sectarian view. We're not these, ideologically motivated people. We just want a good solid basis for our conversation. And since we're right in that way and we're open-minded in that way, I do think that ultimately we can win if we try hard enough.
Good points. Well, you talked a bit there about, I would say, maybe moderate believers preventing us from actually criticizing the more extremist of the religion. You know, for example, they almost enact as enablers. Whenever you go to criticize Islam in general and the extremists there, it seems that, you know, religious people in general sort of say, you know, you should try to be a little more sensitive about it and things like that. And you also bring up the point in your movie where you talk about Fred Phelps and the fundamentalist Christians actually, you know, they're doing what the scriptures are telling them to do, and they're actually being true to the literal word of the Bible.
Yeah.
But I mean, you got to think that like moderates and things like that who say this part of the Bible is allegory or this part is just a moral lesson or something like that, that, you know, they're sort of denigrating their own God's work. They're possibly even offending him in some way. I'm always amazed by that. So,
yeah, I think the fundamentalist Christians, the position of fundamentalist Christians essentially has much more intellectual integrity to it than the position of moderate Christians. You know, the fundamentalist Christians say this is the inspired word of God and you can't pick and choose. You have to take it as it is. And we have to just try to figure out exactly what it really says and what God really meant. Now, they're obviously insane in thinking that, you know, God wrote a book. But if you accept their premise, then everything that they do makes sense. But moderate Christians essentially say, no, we can pick and choose. It's a divinely inspired book, some moderate Christians will say. But, you know, we'll throw out this part, we'll throw out that part, we'll throw out the other part. And clearly, you know, they don't really believe that the book is, you know, has any kind of magical power. They really don't believe it's divinely inspired. But they won't just say, hey, it's just a book and there's really no reason to have a religion about it. You know, they essentially won't follow through on their own good impulses. And for that reason, I really have probably more contempt for moderate Christianity than I do for fundamentalist Christianity.
Right.
But clearly, they have a glimpse of the truth, but they won't acknowledge it.
And they always throw out the parts that really just don't make them comfortable. You know, they'll throw out Leviticus or something like that because, you know, we supposedly live in a more tolerant age now, and things like that just, you know, they're not tolerated in polite society anymore.
Yeah, people don't like it when you sell your daughters into slavery these days.
Right.
I do acknowledge, obviously, that if fundamentalists ruled the world, it would be worse than if moderates ruled the world. I mean,
yes.
There's a certain sort of benefit that one gets from the intellectual, you know, muddiness of moderate Christians. Doesn't make what they think very sound, but obviously they're less dangerous than the fundamentalists are. But I pretty much have the same feeling toward people who, it's not necessarily with Christianity, but they say, well, you know, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. And they say vague things like, there's something there. And I often see, you know, people who are really prominent, like, say, Bill Maher, who could be making a much better influence, I think, on the culture, who say things like that. Clearly, they see the light. They get it. They know that there's really nothing there. But for some reason, they don't want to be seen as rude or something. I don't know what it is, but there's a sort of a stepping up to the void, seeing it for what it is, and then stepping back and claiming the void isn't there, that I found a little bit cowardly. And so I feel the same way about those who try to hold on to some kind of vague notion of spirituality instead of going all the way and admitting that, you know, there's just nothing to these supernatural doctrines whatsoever.
Did you say that you have heard Bill Maher stating that he's spiritual? I always thought he was an atheist. We were just talking about this last night.
We watched the show,
he was even ripping on God last night.
Yeah.
He's a great crusader against religious intolerance and against religious bigotry. But every now and then he says, well, of course, there's something there. He's said that phrase before.
Uh-huh.
Or
I've heard him
close
say
to
that,
it.
Yeah.
And I've always wanted to.
Now, there's something there. It's a big black blank space.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's sort of a little, you know, it's like he doesn't want to be one of those hardcore atheists. So he says, well, there's something there, you know, to make people feel a little bit better.
Uh-huh.
Didn't he actually do a show called Politically Incorrect? You would think that Bill Maher, if anybody, would
think
have
he could handle that.
Yeah,
right. Yeah.
Would be un-PC.
I don't know. I haven't watched the show in a very long time, so maybe he's changed his mind. But I remember being upset by that, knowing that he clearly sees the harm that religion can do, and still he takes the little miniature cop out at the end.
Right. Of course, you know, when push comes to shove, the world would be a much better place if everybody were that type of theist.
Right.
You know,
right.
If that's the only brand of theism on this planet, I think we could all get along in harmony and not even care about it. You know?
Definitely. I mean, our country was founded by those kinds of deists, essentially. So
I thought
if we could get back to the you know, the principles and the values of our founding fathers. I think that would be a great thing.
I'm so used to hearing somebody say our country was founded on Christians when you started making that comment. I thought that you were going to say.
Yeah, I often get that question in interviews when I'm on these right-wing shows. That's sort of a given. Well, since our country was founded on Christian values, how can you be against Christianity? And it's always a jolt to that host and his audience to find out, you know, that's actually not true. You know, they usually can't accept it, but of course they can't argue against it because they clearly haven't researched the issue and found out that Thomas Jefferson was really the next thing to an atheist. And, looked at the writings of Tom Paine and others.
I'm curious, Bri, from your movie, have you had anybody come to you and say they've been enlightened or awakened by this movie?
I've had many people come and say that the movie was part of their deconversion experience. I haven't anybody solely credit the movie, but several people have said that the movie, along with Sam's book and along with some other things, was a critical part of it.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, it is impressive.
Yeah, that's what it's for. that's what the movie's for. I mean, it's for people like us to, you know, acknowledge to each other, oh yeah, that's right, we're sane. It has that effect as well. But really what it's for is to destroy faith. And you know, that's what I consider the movie to be, essentially a faith destroyer, to go out there and do its work.
Oh, that's great. I love that term, faith destroyer. Yeah.
There's also the other side of the coin, though. I'm sure you've received a lot of negative reactions to the film as well. What has that been like?
I like those reactions. What I like the best is when I go to screenings and do Q&As, and I see a very, very upset evangelical believing Christian, and I can tell that person's never going to be the same after having been confronted with the ideas in the movie. You know, they walk into the theater thinking, oh, this stupid atheist, I'm going to show him, and then I can see in their eyes that they're completely shaken and, you know, a bit inarticulate after having seen the movie, because they just, you know, religious leaders never even confront these issues. It's not like they deal with them and then give their flock the answers. They just don't deal with these issues because they can't. You know, there are these ideas out there that can destroy faith, and preachers are just too smart to bring them up. And this movie does, though, and it attracts some Christians to it. So I like it when they're angry with me, and you know, they just do this ad hominem attack on me, because that means I got to them.
Right.
You know, their faith is never going to be as strong as it was.
Brian, for the people listening, especially our Christian audience, that have no idea what types of arguments, you know, were in this movie that would have shaken somebody's faith. This is no spoiler here, because the information is readily available online. In fact, I think all three of us here agreed with your movie before we saw it.
Yeah.
But the fact remains, and Rook, you can expand on this a lot more than I can, but
sure.
The fact remains that 40 years went by between the time that Jesus died and anybody ever wrote about him.
I think it's longer than that, actually.
It most likely is longer. That's about the minimum it could have been.
Right. It's 40 years is cutting it really close.
Like no other person in history. I mean,
well, people were talking.
Not at least not that important. You know?
No. I mean, like Brian had touched on his film. I've written quite extensively on this, especially on Paul. Paul is always talking about a very spiritual, metaphorical Jesus when he writes, and as Brian's said in his film, there really isn't any mention of a lot of the incidents that take place in the gospel. Really, no physical attribute was ever applied to Jesus, and really the only thing he talks about a resurrection and a crucifixion. But the crucifixion, especially when you take it back to the original Greek it was written in, you have crucifixion actually means more of, you know, shoveling. You know, it's very close to shoveling, and he's referring to more of a metaphorical rebirth and metaphorical death of the soul and the spirit. And when Jesus comes to us in a vision or comes to us to enlighten us, it's not like he was physically there or physically came. It's more like he was physically or spiritually enlightening everybody he touched. And there's like 4 authentic works from Paul, and all the rest are considered penned by other people in Paul's name. I think there's like 2 in dispute, like 1 Thessalonians, and but like really Galatians and Romans are like the 2 most authentic, and then there's 2 more that are considered authentic. So really, like most of the New Testament is just, you know, penned 120 CE to like...
Like 90 years after Jesus died.
Yeah.
Earl Doherty has a great name for looking at the writings of Paul and finding, you know, the life of Jesus in there somehow. Is you have to look at the writings of Paul through gospel-colored glasses, which means that you read what he's writing and you fill in all the blanks that
right.
that are there. And when you actually take off the gospel-colored glasses and you look at basically what the record of early Christianity, it's virtually undeniable. You know, you can deny it, you know, based on one chance in a million, but it's undeniable that they believed in a mythical Christ. And basically the story of Jesus, if somebody were to tell it to you right now from beginning to end, they'd have no idea what that story was. Who is that guy?
It's a vague, you know, shadowy figure.
Born in Bethlehem, the whole story all the way up until the death and resurrection. And of course, coincidentally, around this time, there were all these savior cults that were, you know, the most popular religious trend of the moment. And all of these savior cults had a God-man savior figure who would die and would rise, you know, stay dead for 3 days and then rise up to his father in heaven. And, you know, this, it's pretty clear that Christianity was one of these cults. It was a Christ cult, and their savior figure was named, you know, Christ Jesus, as Paul calls him. And he had a Jewish tint to him because mostly it was Jews in the early Christ cults. But, you know, it just as easily could have been the cult of Attis or Mithras or Dionysus or any of these other savior gods.
Right.
Hey, Brian, we're going to take a quick break right here. We're going to play Is This the Real Thing and take a quick commercial break and come right back, okay?
Okay.
The Rational Response Squad has taught me that I don't have to say under God in school when I pledge to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The Rational Response Squad can be found at www.rationalresponders.com. Check them out today.
This is just a simulation.
We're back with Brian Flemming. That song was Is This the Real Thing off the God Movie soundtrack. You can find the God Movie at www.thegodmovie.com. And Rook, you had a question for Brian.
Yeah, this is Rook Hawkins again. I just wanted to ask you, when did you first come up with the notion or the philosophy that there was no Jesus? I mean, I've come up with this for a while and I've thought about this, but I'm wondering when you first came to think that.
Well, when I ran across the idea, I actually just thought it was some wild crackpot theory, and I was interested in it for that reason, because I have kind of a hobby of investigating crackpot theories and looking at the sort of the psychological reasons that people need to believe in them. The JFK assassination was an obsession of mine for a while. And in that one, I went in believing that there must have been a conspiracy to assassinate JFK because, you know, everybody said so. And then came out of it, you know, convinced that it was basically like a religion and there really wasn't all that much going for any of these theories. They were just exciting to believe in.
Right.
This was the reverse, where I went in thinking I was investigating something like this religious cult of, you know, believing Jesus didn't exist because, you know, somehow people were ideologically motivated to believe that. And then I started looking at the evidence and I just became astonished that I ever believed Jesus existed because I couldn't articulate a single reason that I believed that. I couldn't point to, you know, because, you know, this historian of, you know, early first century wrote about Jesus or what, you know, all the things that would have made a reasonable person believe that Jesus existed, I realized just weren't there. And and it was amazing that I ever believed that, you know, even after I became an atheist, that I believed Jesus existed, considering that there isn't any historical evidence that he did.
Right. I think we all agree with you on that.
So now why is it that do you think that Christians don't know about this lack of evidence and about the real story of Jesus? You know, it seems to me that it's atheists and apostates that generally know the story so much better. Is it, you know, a case that, you know, once you really learn all this stuff, you pretty much have no choice but to give up that belief?
Yeah, it's sort of, as Robert M. Price puts it, to explain it is to refute it. You know, once you actually start trying to explain Christianity and go back to the sources, you realize that there's nothing there. It's certainly nothing solid. And you realize just how utterly horrible some of these early Christians were and the things, the lies they told and the things they did and the murders they committed and basically how this whole religion was built. You know, I think early Christianity was probably, you know, a pretty great thing. It was, you know, sort of a club where you got together and you kind of meditated upon the idea that maybe you could have eternal life, that you could have an immortal soul. And it was sort of a club where you would go and you know, feel you had some hope of transcendence of this life, and then it just became this totally different thing. I lost myself there, though. What was your question again?
Just why Christians don't know this story, and it's just they're not taught it. Very few Christians, in my experience, have actually read the Bible and have actually done any sort of research on the subject. It's what they are told in church, and that's pretty much all they know.
Yeah, it's amazing that religion gets away with that, you know, people don't form sort of scientific or mathematical beliefs based upon just being told something. You usually have to demonstrate that they work, but religion gets a total free ride on that kind of thing. And I think to a certain degree, as a whole, Christianity is afraid to investigate itself, and most mm-hmm. Christians don't know the history of their religion because essentially they're guided by the leaders of the Christian religion not to investigate. And everybody's led to just assume the same set of principles and repeat them over and over and over again. And it's sort of this indoctrination into a belief system that sort of gets reinforced over and over again with these rituals and saying the same things over and over again. And certainly not with, you know, an actual investigation of the Bible. I don't know what the percentage would be, but it's got to be very small of Christians who have actually read the Bible from cover to cover. You know, people the Christian religion just rules their lives, and they believe that because they believe in it, they're going to heaven. It's that important to them. They probably still, it's like a one book in their home they haven't read from cover to cover, because so many Christians who do, like Julius Sweeney, they end up, you know, as soon as they read the whole Bible from cover to cover, they start drifting away from Christianity.
That's how it worked for me.
Yeah. So I encourage Christians to read the Bible and at least, you know, get as knowledgeable as the atheists you keep hearing talking about the Bible, you know.
Some more questions from the fans. Geek submitted a question off of MySpace, and he was curious, of the interviews taken during the filming of the God movie. And I believe that he's referring to the Robertson Convention. It was a convention in the movie. Who was?
Yeah, the Billy Graham.
Billy Graham Convention.
Yeah. Pasadena.
Yeah, exactly. Was there even one Christian interviewed that knew any of the answers to some of your harder questions beyond, you know, who was Jesus?
Well, most Christians didn't even know, couldn't answer the question, who was Jesus, in a historical way. But no, I have a feeling that some people think in these on-the-street interviews, essentially, that are right outside a Billy Graham crusade in Pasadena are sort of cherry-picked to make Christians look bad. But I chose the very, very best of the lot.
That's scary.
Yeah, there was one guy who was somewhat knowledgeable, and by that I mean when we said, have you heard of Dionysus, Mithras, or Attis, and that mentioned a few others, said, well, I've heard the name Dionysus. And, you know, he basically says he's heard of it and he knows it has something to do with Greece. And then asked, was he a contemporary of Jesus or the early church?
I remember that one.
And that was the most knowledgeable person. And I included just every single second of our interview with him to, you know, basically give that select group of people the best representative I could.
My favorite was the guy who said, I forget who it was. It was Mithra or Dionysus. You know, the question was asked.
I haven't seen it on the news.
Yeah, the Christian goes, you know, I've heard of those people, but I'm not sure. And he goes, was that you questioning them or was it somebody else?
That was Keith Farley, a Presbyterian minister, actually.
Oh, jeez. So Keith questioned him again, something like, you know, well, have you heard of Mithra? And he goes, yeah, I heard the name before on the news.
Yeah, exactly.
He's like, I don't really pay attention to the news much.
He's yeah,
like, the news.
They had a very, very sympathetic interviewer in Keith Farley, who is a minister, a lay minister at his church. I won't say the name of it, but a Presbyterian church here in L.A. And he's my good friend. We co-wrote a musical called Bat Boy the Musical together, and you know, we always have interesting conversations because he's a practicing Christian and I'm not, obviously. But I chose him because I wanted to make sure that, you know, when we were interviewing Christians, they had, you know, somebody who was in their camp, in their corner, and wanting to present them the best that he could. So, and that's who they had.
Wow. Yeah, it's incredible. Because, well, yeah, that is exactly the claim that you said, that people thought that you would cherry pick the people that looked the worst. So it's quite funny to hear those were the people.
Well, what do you expect at a Billy Graham convention, though? Seriously.
Well, I have to admit, it was really great interviewing those people because they were so high coming right out of there that you got a contact high from them. And it was a great object lesson. And, you know, this is how it works. You know, you go, you get them all together, you play a bunch of music, you make them feel like they're going to live forever, and they leave just on top of the world. But of course, kids coming out of a rave would look exactly the same. They're feeling the same sort of spiritual and togetherness as well. You know, I think the kids coming out of the rave would probably be psychologically a little better equipped to face the world, actually. But
you're probably,
you know,
right about that.
It was definitely a legitimate, you know, drug that they got in there that really worked on them and made them great.
Brian has a theory on that, actually.
What theory is that?
He's about theism being a mental illness.
Oh, well, yeah, no, I don't have a theory on it. That's what it is. Yeah, theism is, you know, in my opinion, a mental illness. And, you know, I always tell people that what I do for a living is I am a...
You cure theism.
Yeah, I'm a curer of theism, that I, you know, that I'm looking for the inoculation of truth. And that I'm, you know, I want to inject it into the hearts and minds of all theists around the world. So,
yeah, I think I don't think that's at all. I wouldn't even say that that's a facetious sort of analogy. It is a mental illness. It's I mean, if you believe, if you change just a few words in what Christians believe and make it space aliens or something, they would be defined as insane if they believed it. You know, like Sam Harris points this out too. I mean, they believe they think that, you know, Catholics believe that because something happens that the minister, that the priest does, a cracker becomes a human being who they then eat. You know, in any other context, this would be considered insanity.
Cannibalism.
So there's no reason for us to give religion a pass. You know, it is insanity. People who believe these things have a serious mental problem. I think it's very curable. In fact, I know it is because I used to have the disease and I managed to free my mind of it.
Can you talk a little more about back when you were a fundamentalist? When did you actually give up that school of thought and finally decide on atheism? I mean, you obviously didn't become an atheist in the process of making this movie. So what was it for you that really caused you to move away from Christian fundamentalism?
I have a feeling that because my particular indoctrination in Christianity was absolute hardcore fundamentalism, it might have been a bit easier for me to see the light once I escaped. I went to a fundamentalist Christian school called Village Christian Schools. It's in Sun Valley, California, and it is just a straight down the line. You know, the Bible is the complete infallible word of God. All the reasons that you're going to go to hell. I mean, it's fundamentalist Christianity in its most pure form that's drilled into the students every day. And ultimately, when I believed everything while I was in the school, which was roughly until very late high school when I left. And after I left, I kind of just ignored what I never really repudiated. I stopped thinking about it. I sensed some kind of hypocrisy among the people who were teaching me there, but I didn't really turn my back on it. And it was really only when I went to college and I started learning specific things that contradicted the doctrine that I was taught, such as the theory of evolution, which of course is utterly ridiculed at my school. And I thought only idiots would believe that we came from monkeys and, a lot of the other things that the way that sin works and how we're going, how we're going to get over our sins and starting to question the whole system that God set up where he has to send his own son to be tortured and killed so that he can correct a mistake that obviously God made, so starting to think logically and questioning things like that. Eventually I realized that just about everything I was taught there was false and started looking at the world in a more realistic way. But it was a very slow, gradual process for me that included a period where I just was unreligious and not so much an atheist, where I just stopped thinking about religion, realized that, clearly those people were nuts, but never really thought any further than that.
Right. You actually interviewed, I guess it was your old principal or
the superintendent of the school. Yeah.
He obviously wasn't prepared for that. And he referred to what he called undeniable historical evidence for Jesus.
Which not exists.
Which, obviously it's certainly deniable. But some of the things other than the Gospels that a lot of Christians like to bring up would be like Josephus and bit mentions of Jesus and other things. I take it you obviously dismiss those writings for similar reasons as you dismiss the Gospels?
Yeah, it's telling what Christians cling to when they talk about the evidence that there is and how basically there's this tiny few scraps where there should be a voluminous record and they're decades later than they should be. And somehow that's good enough for Christians. For example, Tacitus just talking about basically giving a description of Christians in the second century. Like nobody denies that they existed in the second century. People say, well, that proves Jesus existed. He talks about, these Christians who worship a man named Christus. He even gets the name wrong. And, somehow that's evidence that Jesus must have existed because he relates in an unbiased way, essentially, the beliefs of Christians, many, many decades after Christ was supposed to have lived. So the fact that they point to these things, they're either forgeries or they don't really, confirm the existence of Jesus. And the fact that they can't acknowledge that there should be so much more and so much better stuff than they've got to point to is what makes me essentially dismiss their arguments. There's almost nothing there, really.
There actually is really nothing there. Absolutely nothing.
Apologists are expert at turning nothing into something. Yeah, they'll tell you. It's these same people who quote the Josephus from nothing, and all that.
That's great. Just like God. How about that?
Yeah. I mean, they're equally convinced that the resurrection occurred. I mean, that's where they're coming from.
Right.
As far as they're concerned, there's just as much evidence that the resurrection occurred as there is that Jesus existed. So that tells you what their standards are.
Well, yeah. And on that note, even if there was simply a man named Jesus, just a historical person, even if that could be proven, what is one really proven? Without the miracles, without the death and resurrection, isn't Christianity still pretty much founded on a sham?
Yeah, I think it might be the reason I say that, it's extremely unlikely that Jesus existed. I never say with 100% certainty because, we'll never get there on any question like this to 100%. It's more like 99.9. There may have been a traveling itinerant preacher named Yeshua completely by coincidence that existed in that region. And the odds aren't extreme against that. So in that case, yeah, there was a guy named Jesus and he was a preacher, but that's about all they'd have, that he was born in a manger and attended by wise men and performed miracles and was crucified by Pontius Pilate. That didn't happen, but there might've been a guy named Jesus walking around.
Josephus lists about 20 Jesuses living around the time of Christ supposedly living. So Jesus was a common name. It was
In fact,
the priest brother of James was named Thomas and Jesus rather. I'm sorry. He was killed basically. So Jesus was so common that even priests were named Jesus. So I mean,
it wasn't an unusual name.
It was a guy named Jesus living in that time. It's just not the Jesus they're talking about. It's just
yeah. I have a feeling that it's not a Christian on the planet who would be satisfied with just, well, there's some guy named Yeshua. That would be good enough. You know?
Right, right.
Hey, Brian, another question submitted by one of the fans, Got Skepticism wrote, have you been contacted or rebuked by any Falwell or Robertson types, and have you ever sought a personal interview with either of those men?
Yeah, I did seek an interview with Pat Robertson, got no response whatsoever from his organization. I tried a couple different paths and didn't get anything. I haven't really been approached by any of them. I am basically criticized from afar by the Focus on the Family organization and the American Family Association on their radio shows. Strangely, the musical that I co-wrote named Batboy, the musical, that has become the focus of James Dobson of Focus on the Family. He did a whole radio show devoted to the horrible, godless play, Batboy, the musical. And apparently, at that time, he didn't know I made a movie called The God Who Wasn't There. It was a bit more, a bit stronger criticism of Christianity than Batboy.
Well, the name of the musical is Batboy, the musical?
Oh, yeah, it's great.
Yeah, Batboy, the musical.
It's great. If you guys haven't seen it, you definitely need to check it out.
Where can we get more info? Info on that. Is there an official site for it?
BatboyTheMusical.com.
Okay.
And at Amazon, the soundtrack and the script are on Amazon. It's an off-Broadway musical that hit New York in 2001 and since went on to Toronto and the West End in London. And now it's in amateur productions all over the place. So that the best way for anyone listening to maybe see Batboy is to check your local theater and see if they're doing Batboy.
Right. Only musical I've ever liked.
Yeah, what is it about? What's it about,
me
Brian?
Too.
Like Jesus Christ Superstar?
Yeah, Jesus Christ Superstar, maybe, aside.
Brian, what's it about?
Batboy is a musical that's based on a character invented by the Weekly World News tabloid. He's half bat, half boy, discovered in a West Virginia cave. And the Weekly World News, starting around 1991, started doing a series of articles about this utter freak that they invented in basically in their dark room using dark room techniques of this this huge bug-eyed, fang little boy who's a half bat and half boy. And my co-authors Lawrence O'Keefe and Keith Farley and I decided, well, let's make a musical that's a tragic life story of this character, and that's what Batboy is. It's this bad boy's tragic life story. He's discovered in a cave and he's taken to a family's home and he's raised as a human boy, but ultimately the town can't accept him and he meets his doom at the hands of the town.
Wow.
It's and
did it have something to do with theism?
Well, I mean, it sort of does, because there's actually people who believe Batboy exists, and if there's people who believe in Batboy, believing in Jesus really isn't a stretch at that point,
No. Actually, there is more evidence for Batboy than there is for Jesus.
Yeah, there's photographic evidence.
I've seen pictures of Batboy.
Yeah, right.
I can point to newspaper articles written about him, contemporary ones.
We can go to the cave.
Actually, Batboy does have a sort of a criticism of Christianity running through it. There's good Christians and bad Christians in Batboy, and the good Christians are essentially those who have the values of that we would call Christian values, or some people would call Christian values, and the bad Christians are essentially intolerant. And I am just convinced that's why James Dobson, A Focus on the Family, has zeroed in on it. I mean, he realizes that it's the town itself is kind of a character, and its intolerance is very similar to the intolerance of fundamentalist Christianity against gays and basically anybody who's different. And Batboy becomes a symbol for that. And I don't think there's anybody in someone's shoes like James Dobson who doesn't realize that they're being made the villain of this play.
So, what we should do? We should actually, the soundtrack was so darn good, Brian. I want to play another one of these songs. This is The God Who Wasn't There off of The God Movie soundtrack. Visit The God Movie at www.thegodmovie.com. Please support Brian. Buy the movie today. We will be back in a minute.
Sing me a song. One night I dreamed that I was walking along the beach with God. Across the sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand. One belonged to me, and the other to God. But I noticed something strange. I noticed that many times along the path of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I also noticed that it happened at the hardest times in my life. I said, God, I have noticed that during the most difficult times of my life, there is only one set of footprints. I don't understand why when I needed you the most, you would leave me. God replied, I didn't leave you. During your times of trial and suffering, when you see only one set of footprints, that was when I carried you.
Right about now, huh? I'll take you where you wanna go. Gotta open up.
I said to God, you carried me? What the fuck are you talking about? My dog died. My sister got killed in a car accident. Maybe instead of carrying me, you could have stopped these bad things from happening at all. Did you ever think about that, you fucking prick? And God replied, you stupid human. Do not question the Lord. I fuck with you, and then I carry you. It's just something that I enjoy doing. If you don't like it, you can just go to hell.
Right about now, huh? I'll take you where you wanna go. Gotta open up.
God, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. I just don't understand why you make everybody suffer so much just so you can carry them on the beach. But that's cool. That's your thing. God, wait, come back. Please, come back, God. I need
great
you.
Song, man.
Thank you.
I think I have cancer.
That was a great song.
The performer there is the voice Fred in the Macintosh operating system.
Aha.
Oh, wow.
That's who sings that song.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, I was wondering how you did that.
Yeah, I just typed out the lyrics and had Fred automatically read them and recorded that.
We might want to have Fred on for a future appearance on our show.
I think that's a good idea.
I can arrange that for you. But a little slow in his responses, and you hear typing beforehand, but
he my father suggested we have Hawking on, and I said, I don't think I get Hawking on, but I might be able to get like a computer voice to do Hawking.
Yeah, you could have in quotes Stephen Hawking on.
Yeah.
I know at some point we're going to have Satan on, so that should be an interesting show.
Yeah, Satan's going to be joining
us. I'll
tune
in for that, definitely.
And God is a recurring, proposed guest?
Yeah, well, of course, God always has an invite onto our show. Right. We can Skype God or...
He
could probably call straight into us through a regular phone line, I would imagine.
He can call through...
Even though I don't have the computer hooked up like that, you know, you would think he would have the power to do that.
Oh,
so,
yeah, definitely.
In fact, God, if you're listening, you know, go ahead, call in right now.
Yeah, we'd love to hear from you. Irrational Response Squad is waiting for your call.
Brian, there's another question here. This is another one of those predict the future for us, Brian, questions.
Okay.
Given America's current trend towards Christianization and merging church and state, do you think that we will become a theocracy, or will people finally become fed up and cause the pendulum to shift back towards secularism?
That I don't know, but it's a good question in that clearly we could become a theocracy. I think a lot of people think that's far-fetched, and I always ask them, okay, well, what would it look like if we were heading toward theocracy? And they tend to describe events that would only be occurring if we were already, you know, there and it was inevitable and we couldn't bring ourselves back. And I try to urge people to look at our situation and think, okay, now what would it look like at that point where we're about to inevitably head toward theocracy, but we could still pull it back if we worked really hard? What would that point look like? And I would say that point looks like it would look like it does right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Unfortunately, yeah.
Yeah. And if we wait and we wait until the signs are essentially that, you know, we're going to have a complete Christian theocratic takeover of government and it's too late. If we wait and say, oh, well, actually now I think it's happening, that's going to be too late. I mean, there's only so much citizens can do to pull the government back after it's had a takeover like that. If you look at, you know, Germany, for example, is obviously the example often given. Like, look how fast it can happen. And, you know, what you want to do is look at that example and look, okay, where were the warning signs? What could they have done 2 years before it was inevitable if they'd worked hard enough? And I think we always have to be looking at our country that way in terms of, you know, how bad could it get and what would it look like? So, yeah, I think we could become a theocracy. I think, you know, sort of fascism mixed with theocracy would be that seems to be the mix that many people on the right are heading toward. The sort of Bush worship is very, very religious and tied in with the Christian evangelical movement. But also, we could bring it back if people like us fight hard enough and we constantly expose these hypocrites for what they are and fight them and raise our voices in warning like we're supposed to as citizens of the United States of America. I think that we can stop theocracy from taking over.
You know, it's funny that we're talking about this before, but we have people that write us almost every day and ask us, why are we making the arguments we make? We're the atheists writing us, telling us basically to just stop. There's no point. Is,
yeah.
You know, give it up, that you're just disrespecting people. You know, why do we want to never listen to those atheists? And you know, and furthermore, do you have any idea what would make an atheist, you know, so jaded that they would think that the proper thing to do is just shut up and let the country, you know, and world be driven into the ground? I mean, I can't figure it out.
I can't. Sometimes I wish we had a better word for atheists, because as Julia Sweeney points out in her show, Letting Go of God, which I saw recently, it's sort of letting the other side define us, you know, that we're atheistic, you know, it's like they should call themselves a-naturalistic, you know, religious right. Is how she puts it. Uh-huh. And it's hard, you know, it's hard to, when the name that you have is defining what you're against rather than what you're for. I think if we look at it as what we're for is looking at facts and looking at reason and using a sensible perspective from which to look at the world and solve our problems, that makes a lot more sense. And really, nobody's against that. I don't understand why so many atheists don't see that that's essentially what the atheist movement is and the humanist movement is. It's really about not using insanity as a replacement for sanity in our discourse. I can't figure those guys out either. People are just like, you atheists, you're just, you know, they're atheists, but they think anybody who would join a group and actually try to do something to make the society more secular is like, you guys are just a religion too.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that one sucks. I hate that one all the time.
Yeah, we always
yeah,
have that.
They just shake their heads at me. It's just that, as if organizing to do good is an evil in and of itself.
Yeah, so all car clubs
anything, anybody organizing to do good is religious somehow. I just don't get it, and it's very frustrating.
So the next question we have here from the list of submitted questions, I believe this is our winner. I just picked it random today. So
okay.
Snoop is going to get a copy of the God Movie DVD, and we'll have to contact Snoop to get, I believe it's a him.
Yeah.
I'll have to contact Snoop to get his address. And in fact, anybody else who wants to try to win a God Movie DVD, Brian was nice enough to submit 20, in fact, 30 copies, if you include what the infidel guy got. Brian sent us 30 copies of the movie to help promote ourselves, help promote him, and we're extremely appreciative of that.
Very appreciative.
So we have a couple of contests on our forums, some ways that you can help promote Brian and the Infidel Guy and our show, the Rational Response Squad. You can go to www.rationalresponders.com, and in the one of the top forums there, Rational Response Squad, you'll see a couple of the contests and different ways that you can try to win a movie, and we'll be giving these out through shows in the future as well. But the question from Snoop was that, Do you believe people of faith should not be allowed to hold political positions as their faith impairs logical, rational decision making?
I don't actually believe that because unfortunately, some of the very best, most qualified people we have, you know, also proclaim to be part of a religion, whether they are or not, you know. So only on the grounds that it's impractical would I reject that proposal. I wouldn't mind a sort of an oath that you have to take that you are more dedicated to your country than you are to your God. Mm-hmm. I could see requiring everyone who takes office to have an allegiance to their country before their religion, because anyone who would have an allegiance to their particular religion and their particular sect, you know, almost always that's going to mean that they're not essentially they have no allegiance to most Americans. You know, if you're say have an allegiance to the Catholic Church, well, that means just about everybody else in the country, you know, you don't have allegiance to. So I would like to see government officials who are elected have to pledge to devote themselves to the interests of the country over the interests of their religion. Never happened, but I think it would be a good idea.
And I personally, you know, I mean, John F. Kennedy said there should be no litmus test. We shouldn't judge somebody based on their religious value to run the country. I agree with how you phrased it. But, you know, even then, I could imagine trying to ask George Bush to, you know, to claim that he loves his country more than his God. It's just not going to happen.
Right.
So
yeah, I mean, he wouldn't necessarily have to love his country more than his God, but he would have to
want to defend
pledge allegiance to put the interests of the country before the interests of his God or his religion. I mean, of course, that would make complete sense. I mean, why wouldn't you want that in your leader? I mean, you wouldn't want someone. I can't think of any situation where you want someone to choose the interests of their religion over the interests of their country. I mean, and what possible decision would that be a good idea and a good result for anybody in America? But, you know, it would never happen because, of course, you have to have a blind obedience to God to get elected in the country, unfortunately.
Yeah.
As far as what I do with my vote, though, I would definitely vote for somebody who was not burdened by faith. Myself, if there were atheist candidates, that would make them far more attractive to me.
It's unfortunate.
Not that there are any.
It's unfortunate that most states require you to have a belief in a God in order to run for candidacy of any political position.
Are you kidding me?
No, laws are still on the book in a lot of states.
In Pennsylvania, as a matter of fact.
Still on the book. When did they go on the book?
Probably been there since state laws.
Yeah.
They could probably be challenged. It's just that nobody,
right,
nobody has ever been in a situation where they needed to challenge them.
Right.
So I'd love to see that trial. You know, some atheist runs for office and someone tries to prevent him from taking office, you know, and then they have to challenge these state laws. I think that'd be a great spectacle.
I bet you there's quite a few guys holding positions in this country.
What are you going to run for office there, Rook? You going to run for governor?
Yeah. I think I'm going to run for mayor of Philadelphia first, I think.
I bet you there's quite a few guys holding positions in this country right now that have, you know, because of that law, are holding positions and they're claiming to be religious and they're more agnostic, atheist type people.
Right. Well, it's just something you can't admit. You know, that's political death. You say that you're an atheist, you're not going to be president of the United States.
But
it's just not going to happen.
You say that because in Europe, saying God is actually political death. If somebody in one of the European Union countries stated that, use God in their speeches or in one of their addresses to the public, there's a huge chance that person will not even be elected. And, you know, from my time over there, I was told that quite frequently, as a matter of fact. That's one of the reasons why they have a problem with Bush, is that he's so zealous about using God in everything that if he were ever to run for office over in Europe, let's say he was, you know, running for a parliamentary position in the UK, you know, and he mentioned God, you know, it wouldn't work for him. So it's ironic how that's kind of opposite how Europe is progressed further than we have, you know.
Yeah.
And it's just ironic, you know.
They also don't have the bastardized version of atheism and agnosticism, and they have Darwin on the 10-pound note. So
exactly, yeah.
Mike, you had a question over there?
Yeah, I just had one or two more questions about the movie. A friend of mine actually noticed this and wanted me to ask you about it. In the movie, you use as an example of myth-making the story you wrote about the spammer who was choked to death with a can of spam.
Yeah.
Did you write that story in anticipation of doing the film, or was that just sort of a fun thing to do? And what is your favorite Spam dish? I'm sorry, I was forced to ask that. But, it's out there now, so you owe me one.
I wrote that story out of anger at spammers. Actually, I thought it would be a great lesson to have out there that, you know, this it was a fake news story that I thought could be pretty viral, where it's about this guy who got killed by somebody because he was a spammer, and they killed him by shoving a can of Spam down his throat and leaving him dead by his post office box. Ultimately, I did use it as part of the movie as a demonstration of how completely false stories that were originally labeled as false, because I labeled that as fiction, can start to lose the tag, the label of fiction, and become considered real. And of course, Snopes.com, the urban legends reference pages, have one example after another of this happening, where there's these urban legends that are false, but the people who originally wrote them actually labeled them as fiction and tried to, you know, didn't try to pass them off as true. It's just people thought they sounded better if they were true. So as they passed them along and forwarded them, they just kind of deleted that part at the top.
That story has actually shown up in my inbox as true more than once.
Yeah. So. It kind of reminds me of King Arthur and Camelot. You know, people think that that's a true story too, you know, and it's funny. Yeah.
That's not true.
Never.
No, I'm just kidding.
Or William Tell.
William Tell's another one.
Robin Hood.
Robin Hood, yep.
Wait, Robin Hood wasn't real?
I need that snare tap in that cymbal.
I'll find
crash
some good
right
sound
there.
Effect for that.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, it's like, amazing the arguments people will use when they, you know, say, well, Jesus has to be real because so many people believe in him today.
Mm. Yeah, argument from Popularum.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. Of course, the world is still flat because 70 years ago, everyone believed it,
right? Yeah.
Right. And apparently, you know, Islam must be true because so many people believe exactly. even though it's contradictory to Christianity.
Right. Apparently the Nazis were right because,
Well, Islam is just not as true as Christianity.
There aren't enough of them. They were killed off.
It's 20% true versus 33%.
Right, yeah. It's ridiculous.
Carla submitted a question. What in the Bible bothers you the most?
Where to pick.
Where to start?
You know?
I would say God.
There you go.
He's a horrible, horrible person. If he were a person, he would be a terrible. And look how he is as a parent. Look what he did. He creates people, and they're flawed, and so he destroys them. And you know, he tells people, you know, you can kill these people over here because they're bad, and you're good. And ultimately, his design for the world was that he create man with the ability to sin, get mad that man did sin, and therefore God would have to send his own son knowingly to be tortured and killed in human form so that his son could then rise up to him. And somehow in God's twisted imagination, this is a good way for the world to work. You know, that's, but God bothers me. He's a terrible, terrible model for anybody to look up to.
I definitely agree on that. And again, like with God sacrificing his son, wasn't that supposed to save us? Where is that salvation? You know, nothing's changed. Jesus died. Nothing changed. You know,
and Jesus in the stories in the New Testament, Jesus says that, you know, the world's ending, you know, within the lifetimes of those who are hearing him talk. And obviously that didn't happen. So
whenever we talk about God and how he treated his son and salvation, I'm always reminded of a quote from a poster on the Atheist Network a few years back. His name was Dr. Who. And the quote goes, "Christians must consider why an all-loving, all-knowing God had to come down in human form to sacrifice himself to himself so that others can escape the wrath of himself."
That pretty much sums it up. Yeah.
It's funny because talking about, you know, things that have never changed, in the Bible, in the flood story, okay, God is so upset with his creations that he floods the whole world but leaves Noah, a perfect person, okay, to lead the way for the rest of humanity after the flood waters diminish. What happened there? Why did we somehow go from perfection to imperfection yet again? You know, it's
like right away. I mean, he was drinking
right
away.
It was like, oh,
drunk and
rainbow.
Naked.
You know, like, it's funny because you have an imperfect creation, Adam, doing imperfect things from a perfect being, okay? And then you have flaws left and right with that, you know, his sons and daughters and wherever they came from, you know, wherever they spawned their children from, the sisters and brothers are mating. And you go down the line and then you have, you know, Abraham, imperfection there. He's supposed to be perfect, but Abraham has problems. And then you go down further down the line and you have Noah. Noah was supposed to be perfect. And Yet at the same time, we're not perfect beings. I mean, you think after three tries, you would have gotten it right, you know, the first time.
Especially when it's all known.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then he has to go send down Jesus, another perfect being himself. I guess if you can't do it, you can't have other people do it for you. You got to do it yourself. But he comes down, he fricks it up too. So, you know, what do we have there? We have like four tries and none of them seem to help, you know, like, all right. So you tried the tribe thing, you tried the incest thing, you tried the flood thing, and you tried the sacrifice thing, and none of them worked. What's going to happen next? I'm waiting for a zoo to come down.
Yeah, maybe it's time to try again.
Yeah, maybe it's time for like elephants to come down and, you know, stomp us all out and, you know, two guys are going to be left alive. And
leave the three of us.
Yeah,
leave the three of us. We're the perfect ones.
Yeah, there we go. we'll include Brian Fleming on that too. Brian, come over and hang out. We'll invite the Eagles cheerleaders over, and we'll be all right, you know.
But given the way the sadistic way that God uses His creations as His little playthings, I don't understand why anyone wants to go to heaven.
I don't either.
Do you really think that it's going to be all that great up
there?
He's
a sadistic prick. That's what it comes down to. You know what I mean?
Why do you think it's going to be better in heaven? I mean, God, where God also rules over you and can do anything He wants to you. I mean, look what He enjoys. He enjoys torturing people.
Look at Job.
Look at anybody.
But that's evil. That's Satan's work.
Oh, yeah. It's not like God didn't tell him to
that's
do that
Satan
or anything.
That's Satan doing that, Brian Fleming. You just don't know.
You got a great point there. That's true. I would replace Job with Abraham then.
Yeah. Oh, no.
God didn't create Satan. We know God didn't create Satan. Satan just spawned himself. He's evil.
You were right about Job. God did basically tell Satan to do that. Do your worst. Just don't kill him, but, you know, torture him a whole lot. Take away his family. Kill his livestock. You know, give him all these diseases and all these horrible skin afflictions. Do everything possible to make them want to die, but just don't go that far. It's almost like where it says in the Bible in Leviticus, it's okay to beat your slaves near death, but not totally where they actually die. You know, that's great, God. Thanks. You know, you're glad you're on my side. Now I'm going to make a rap song about you and you know, thank you for all your wonderful deeds and getting me a platinum album. You know, like...
And that touchdown.
Touchdown. But, you know...
That was Satan, actually.
Oh, was it Satan?
Yeah, the touchdown. Yeah, that was.
It's like you planted the fossils, right? Yeah.
Well, maybe if you're like you're a Dallas fan, it was Satan. Another question I had from the movie, Brian. You end it by, you quote Mark 3:29, and you yourself commit the only unforgivable sin when you deny the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
You close the movie by saying that you are not afraid. How has not being afraid changed your life?
That I think is the biggest difference between being a Christian and not being a Christian. Is like when you're a Christian, your life is ruled by fear. You're essentially doing everything you can to make sure you don't go to hell. And you're living in fear of this wrathful God. And even while you're praising him because he's so powerful and he can destroy you. When you leave Christianity, you essentially get to let go of all that fear. And that's why I think I'm a much happier, much more well-adjusted person today than I was, you know, when I was a very confused, frightful Christian. You know, the fear to me is the biggest thing. It's the most powerful force that Christianity has to keep its followers in line. And it's the very best thing that you're rid of when you leave Christianity.
Right. Well, and a lot of Christians would say that fear of hell is where their morals come from. You know, so.
And I'm so afraid of those people.
I know.
The only things I fear now is that people who need a fantasy story about hell to keep them from murdering and raping.
You're basically saying that, you know, if I didn't believe in this fairy tale, in this book, there'd be nothing at all to keep me from robbing, killing, raping, plundering, like looting, you know, at will. And, yeah, you're right. Those people truly do frighten me.
Yeah, I do see the argument that the Jesus character as an example, especially the modified Jesus character, not as he really is in the Bible, but the kind of idealistic version that's created out of the best Bible verses, is a great example to teach children, you know, be like Jesus. Mm. Well, sure, yeah, be like Jesus. He's great. But the idea that, you know, the flip side of that, you know, the only thing that keeps people good is this fear of hell, that frightens me when I hear Christians saying that. It's like that. If that's true, then, you know, we're going to hell in a handbasket because you know, eventually people are going to realize there's no hell. And I guess they're all the Christians especially are going to be apparently murdering and raping and having sex with sheep, which is one of the most popular ones.
Yeah, because apparently without God, then you're this sinful, destructive, murdering rapist.
You are.
Yeah. You didn't know that? Man, I have it written all over my face and everything, you know?
Well, Brian, we've got to wrap up, but, you know, this is actually a great segue because I didn't even realize you were going to ask that question, but I was hoping we would all end the show by all denying the Holy Spirit. Rook, how do you feel about the Holy Spirit?
Oh, I completely deny the Holy Spirit, Brian.
How about you, Mike?
I deny the motherfucking Holy Spirit.
I, too, deny the Holy Spirit. Brian?
I deny the Holy Spirit.
Wow. Excellent, man. That is
Thank you, Brian.
It's a great segue to end as you leave here with your song "Come On to Freedom." So we're gonna play that as we get out of here. But thanks so much for coming on, Brian. Our first episode of the Rational Response Squad.
Yeah, it's great to have you, man.
Thanks, Brian.
Thanks to all you guys. It's been great.
And for you folks out there, you can check us out at www.rationalresponders.com. This song is Come On to Freedom by DJ Madsen, Euro, and Brian Flemming. Check him out at www.thegodmovie.com. Thanks a lot.
Have a good night. Come on to freedom.